And it is a little warm in here, but we're working on some ventilation. So I'd like to, first of all, have the select board members introduce ourselves. And I wanted to introduce Jonathan Williams. He's our select board administrator.
Hi, everybody.
Hello. So,
Rob Richard.
Sharon Wynn Fannin.
I'm Rose Palachuk.
Denise Wheeler.
John Brugan.
I'm Judy Fitch Robert, counselor, not select board.
Jane Olson, chair of planning, I guess.
Yep. Okay, so let's start out.
Yes.
I want to thank you all for coming tonight. I'm sure everyone wants this meeting to go well and leave here with positive energy and a plan to move forward. Originally, this was not going to be a special select board meeting, but the questions were directed to the select board, and we have a quorum of the board. If you would like to speak tonight, please make sure that you sign up so we can make sure that everyone is heard. Jonathan and Rob will be assisting in making sure that everyone is heard, and we have this handy-dandy time clock here. So it's going to be about 2 to 3 minutes by the looks of the size of the crowd. I want to just set some ground rules as we do any other time we have meetings, because we want this to be productive and respectful. We need to work together, not against each other. Calis is a community that is known for working together, because at the end of the evening, we are still all neighbors and we all care about this town. We would ask that you be recognized by the board before you speak. State your name, as not everyone knows everybody. And not interrupt others while they're speaking, and to appreciate and listen to what others have to say, even if you don't agree with them. Last Friday, the board received a list of questions from a group of residents who met last Monday, which we expect this meeting to be what you guys already did for us. So we're very appreciative of the work and the thoughtful effort that you all put into it. We have flip charts to help record and remember what is said here tonight. And you'll note that we've broken down the list of questions into 3 categories, swimming access, Memorial Hall, Veterans Monument, and GAR Road. So those are the main questions that we took from the work that you all did. And please understand that we may not be able to answer all of your questions here tonight. We plan to continue to review all the questions in consultation with our town attorney and look at perhaps holding another meeting sometime in the fall. Perhaps by then, others may be able to help come up with a plan to help the Women's Relief Corps find a solution. Many of the questions can only be answered by the Women's Relief Corps. All questions should still be directed to the board, even if they are questions that you would like answers to from the Women's Relief Corps. And we have here tonight some of the members from the Corps, and I really, really appreciate your coming. And I would like to invite someone from the Corps to speak and just give us a brief history of the organization and what it is, and that maybe not everybody knows. And then we hope you'll stay and help us answer some questions and work together to find a positive outcome to this.
Well, one of the things that we passed out to you, and the issue that was actually before the town and us, was the shoreland. You guys passed regulations in the Planning Commission had written.
Please stand up so we can hear you.
Sorry.
We're getting old, Peg.
Okay, we got 8 changes that we passed out to you. One of the things that happened on the 4th of July was that someone cut out the beach more. So it's now 70 feet wide of the beach area. It's not really, quote, the beach. It's what you guys call the beach. And then we reported that to the zoning administrator because that was a violation of cutting within the 50-foot buffer zone. Then we had a meeting out there, and on the results, on the first page, those were the results of what happened. We wrote a letter to the selectmen. We wrote a letter that went to the state, the Conservation Commission, who helps with this stuff on beach stuff. Jane Olson, who's the Planning Commission, the head of the Planning Commission, they write the laws that you guys voted on. And John McCullough, who is the zoning administrator, who actually writes official notices of violation. He decided that it wasn't enough for a violation. The Planning Commission, and you can read it here, this is the results. So the end of it was there was no violation. There was no action, and the matter was concluded by the town.
Yeah, I think, I'm sorry. Are you done with that?
Yes.
I think what I was looking for history was the history of the Memorial Hall and the organization. If you could enlighten folks as to what...
Well, the history of the building and the hall itself.
Ownership.
When we're not yelling out, I'm sorry.
Ownership.
The history of the hall itself is in the deeds, which I understand the listers are reviewing and are going to give you a report of who owns what on a GAR road, which will include our hall. And they will be giving you and defined the four deeds that we got the property from.
The listers are not in a position to determine ownership?
That's true.
So just to be clear on that, and anybody can go to the town office and review any of the documents.
So you want me to give you the page and telephone and book and page?
I think Jan has a list of all these documents.
So anybody's
welcome to go in and look at them.
Correct.
But the documents.
And
so,
okay. The way we started off was that it started off with Mr. Oncoming. Orlando Leonard, was Janet Strenahan's. She was in the court to start with. It was her great-grandfather. He purchased a piece of land from Warren Chase. The land, when it was purchased, said to build a 30-by-60 building used at the Grand Army or Memorial Hall and for other public uses as in common for such buildings to be used. Keep in good repair and build a 5-strand wire barbed wire fence southerly and westerly of the road in the land. That was done. Orlando then gave it to Memorial Hall Association with no conditions whatsoever. Then we have a request they did for the state of Vermont for an act to exempt the hall. And that exemption was for the Memorial Hall Association only. And said shall be exempt from taxation so long as the use, profits, and increase thereof shall be devoted to the general use and best interest of the Grand Army of the Republic. Says nothing about the land of the hall itself. Then we have Mr. Chase gave us another piece of land. He gave that to the Stoke Post, number 29 of the Grand Army of the Republic. The description was the hill area. When you stand at the hall and if you have your back to the gate, you look across and there's a hill and it's got trees on it. In fact, we put an application in to put a parking lot here a few years ago and got denied. That goes back to the cottage lots. And so we got that piece along with the other piece of the road. So now there's two pieces of the road, the hall, the point, etc. The hall was built, and then the Grand Army of the Republic, who was Mark Goodall and Mr. Haskell as the deed agents, gave everything to the Women's Relief Corps and the Sons of Union Veterans. These two organizations are part of the Grand Army of the Republic. The Grand Army of the Republic consists of five different organizations under it. And in that deed, it said, shall be used only for all patriotic, religious, moral, and instructive purposes, and for no other purposes whatsoever. So all these years, when everybody said that the hall was given to the Women's Relief or to the Sons, as a public building for public uses and public this and public that, it does not say so in the original legal deeds. And so that's where we are. Everything transferred down to us because the last remaining son died. And it was either to the son or to the survivor, which was the Women's Relief Corps.
Okay, well, thank you for sharing that history. So let's start out with some of the questions here. All put together. Let's start with GAR Road. Is it a town highway? This has been a question that's been asked over and over again. So I'm going to try to give an answer. Historically, the town has considered GAR Road to be a fourth-class town highway, and it has been maintained as such by the town. The town believes that the Women's Relief Corps owns the land underlying the town highway easement into the right of way. Nothing has recently come to the town's attention that would change our perspective on that. The town believes the town's right of way for Gar Road includes the travel portion of the road plus some land on either side of the road to perform maintenance. Land under town highways usually belongs to the adjoining landowners, and this is any town road, whether it's fourth class or third class. Land under a town highway usually belongs to the adjoining landowners, but the town has an easement, which is a right of way, for the public to use the road for travel and for the town to plow and perform other maintenance. So that is our answer on GAR Road. The town also believes that the parking area is owned by the Women's Relief Corps. So I would like to give the Women's Relief Corps an opportunity to answer questions about the road.
Well, should we start the list?
Yeah, I think we'll start the list.
We're going to go around with two pads of paper.
Yeah, we'll have the list circulated.
If you'd like to speak to any of this, please put your name on the list, and then we're going to do a time.
If you could just raise your hand so I can come to you, and
we're
going to
go through what everybody put together as a list the other night. And then if there's additional questions, we can then move on to that segment of the meeting.
And with the rental of the hall, the fire department could not get to the hall. If there was a fire, the ambulance could not get to the hall if there was a problem. So we asked the selectmen at that time if they would post, give us a ordinance not parking on that road. And we got the ordinance from Arthur Armstrong, Lester Toby, and Ralph Howe. And at the same time, we put those signs up, and I think it says on the bottom of it, first selectmen. And then on the next sign down, it says all property on this road is privately owned. And everybody's walked by those signs for 20-some years or more, and not one of you reads them. So that was how, that's the road issue. And if you say that you own the road, then you've got to prove the other part. We're ready. We've already put our stuff together to vote for to prove ours.
I think we all need to get a lawyer.
So, and as far as you say, owning additional land beyond the actual land you have road, no, you don't. Because it's a stated right-of-way. Just like in East Callis, the back street is a stated right-of-way. You can't have free rods, because it was never free rods to start. And that was discussed back here in the spring when they were doing some paving.
Yeah, I remember that in East Callis, yeah.
Right,
yeah.
So that's the road.
Okay, the next piece that we focused on was the swimming access. So I would like to give the relief board the opportunity to first address and answer the questions that were put forward by the group that met the other night. You have a list of those questions, Peg, and Kathy, what you thought?
As far as the swimming access is concerned, we didn't do anything officially with that. That was just something that happened over the years where people came in to swim. They thought, some of the people thought they who owned the cottage lots owned the swimming beach. And if you look at the survey that's on file at the town clerk's office, it says, ... you own it. Tammy Leno's camp would be 61 feet, 17 feet for the road access to the cottage lots. And then the rest of it is whoever owns the rest of the lots going out to the fishing access.
As far as ever, I'll stand up. My name's Kathy Silk. I'm president of the Relief Corps. As far as ever being promoted as a swimming access, no, we've never done that. People have always swam there. They still walk across the private property and go out to the point and swim and stuff. Most of them that are out there in the last couple of years has been out of towners, not really townspeople. How they find out about it, I understand it's listed on some website as one of the best places to go, and people in Barry seem to know about it. But we've never promoted it as a swimming access, especially a public one, because the liability would be enormous for us to do that. And that's not, you know, not something that we money-wise can really, you know, take care of or anything. So we've never promoted it as a public swimming whatsoever. The only public swimming that I know of is what it's over at Curtis Pond in this area.
So what you're saying then is nobody closed down public swimming. You haven't posted it or intend to post it or anything like that?
I go by every morning, I come back every night. There's no posted sign on our beach. The posted sign is on the point where the hall is, and that's because you swimmers all bitched and complained last year at a meeting of the town clerk's office that we should post it because of the naked man. I never saw the naked man. We assume that he had a mental problem, but we don't know.
Right, we don't have any.
We don't have.
So that's why there's signs there.
So all the police come when somebody is on that posted property. they could be arrested for trespassing.
Yes.
Is that correct, Peggy?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Even any one of us, you.
Or us.
What about if you want to visit the memorial?
We're not at the memorial.
We're not there yet. You got to put your hands up. So we're going to get there, okay? That's on the list of questions right up here.
Okay, no question.
Okay, so let's move on. The town owns a portion or a public beach at Curtis Pond. How that came to be, I don't know. So there's probably somebody here that has the history of that, and if it's a short history.
I don't think the town of Palos owns it. I think it belongs to the land trust, and I think the town has permission to do it, to use that land as long as there are swim lessons there. I think this because I was on the swim committee back in the 90s, and that's something that could be researched.
Yeah, okay, great, thank you.
Sure.
There was a question about modifying the shoreline. And it's my understanding that if any work on that were to be done, that it would have to go through the state and the town shoreline permitting requirements and regulations. So if any work is done there, they know that that's the process that has to be done. And if there's work in what we consider to be the town's right of way, it would need to be a permit granted by the select board for permission to work in the right of way. Okay, anything else on Memorial Hall, board members? I mean, on the swimming area?
I think we are starting to get some names of folks who want to ask questions.
If you right, would like to speak, I can come to you.
Yeah, if anyone's not on the list, raise your hand and we'll come and grab your name. We've got you.
Questions? What? Procedure questions?
What? Oh, sorry.
The Women's Relief Corps to answer that question.
We'll listen to your comments.
Excuse me?
We'll listen to your comments. We'll approach that at the end.
Okay. We're trying to hold all the questions.
I've just been trying to get on the list. For about 10 minutes. I was just wondering that.
Sure. All right, listen. All right, are we ready to move on to the Memorial Hall issue, which was raised? Can Mark Memorial Hall be preserved? I think we all certainly would like it and be very happy to have it be preserved. It's an important historic building in Calais. I would hope that we would all, and I mean all, be supportive of preserving the Memorial Hall and work together to that end. But I guess I would like to hear from the Women's Relief Corps on about the hall being preserved.
Denise, there's still other questions that are posted up there that haven't been addressed yet.
Which one?
Who closed?
No, we didn't close the beach.
Nobody did.
So who closed the Dale? And my question is it actually closed? I mean,
no, we didn't. Barbara, we went through that question. The beach is not closed.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
And what about the memorial? We didn't address that question.
We're not there yet. We're not there yet, please. We're trying to make sure that we maintain some order here so that we can get through everything.
Going down this list systematically.
I think, does everybody have the list?
You skipped some items on the list. That's the confusion.
I don't think we skipped anything on the list.
You just skipped two and then the answer. That's all I'm trying to say. I think people are confused because you're jumping around.
Memorial Hall. So we asked the question, can Memorial Hall be preserved? I think there's general consensus and agreement that everybody would like to see the hall preserved. The tax exempt status, I'm not in a position to really get into that question tonight. I think that the town does not have any plans at this time on taking any action, nor can we speculate what might happen in the future.
So if I might provide a clarification, because I spoke with some people before the meeting, there's some confusion. With John Braben again, the select board. The tax exempt status as applies to that hall is a continuing status, unlike other buildings in town, which we grant periodically and re-up, and that's done at the local level. Their exemption from taxation is a state level exemption. It was done through the legislature. So any, so.
Yep.
When was it?
1888.
In 1888. So I don't have good memory of it. I was really young. But that's a continuing thing right now. If people think it's being misapplied or shouldn't apply, that's an issue for the Attorney General's office, not the Town of Callis Select Board. Okay?
Can I add? The exemption is for the organization that runs it. The exemption is not for the hall or the property. So the exemption goes with that organization. So if that were to go become a private or some other nonprofit organization that owned it, then they would be in the position of being taxed unless the town graciously said they would make up the education tax that they're paying.
Right,
and just so you know, it's not, I always thought it was a village, it's not. The organization, because they were connected to the grant program.
Yeah, I mean, and I think most folks that go to town meeting know that we have exempted a few properties in town from taxation over the years. Okay? So on that, why isn't the hall land open to the public? I think Peggy answered that.
Naked man. Sorry, I couldn't hear you.
She said naked man. But the, I think
we also addressed it in our text.
I think people want to know about the use and access to the hall. I think it used to get rented out.
Okay, the hall has the same problem pretty much as this building, except this building has more. The supports under the first floor, not the walls or anything of that nature, just the supports under the first floor were put in with pieces of wood with the bark still on. And the way they stuck it together, they assumed that it would last, 50, 60, 70 years. I mean, they never expected it to live this long. And then, when we were renting it out, the two people that were involved with renting it at that time gave me a call and said pieces of rotten wood, which is on the floor, and it's only got one layer of boards, is starting to pop off in the bathrooms, in the dining room, etc. So that's when I called in, engineer, Rick DeWolf.
Yeah.
And his group all came over and took a look at the hall, and he said, you cannot put any people into that building. The second floor would be fine, but if you rent the building, somebody's going to only use the first floor. They can't. And so he said, you've got to pull the rentals of the building, and you've got to do a steel, it should be steel support, because you've got two stories, and you need to put steel beams in, and then you need to take out those others. You need to dig out, we would have to dig the floor down, because right now if you tried to replace the floor, you'd be laying on your back because it's a crawl space.
Yeah.
So that has to come out. Then we have to replace the front wall, which we never replaced, because that's where the porches were, until we took the porches off. And so the whole thing, he estimated out about $295,000 to fix it, just that. Then you're going to have the same things as this building. We have a new roof, we have a new new foundation, but we need new windows, we're going to have new siding, it just continues on and on and on with an old building. But if someone comes up with, the amount of money to fix it, yes, it can be fixed. that will be the problem. It will be just the basement, first floor support.
When was that study done by DeWolf?
Back before he left, 2 years. When we shut the hall down.
Yeah. Can I just remind people to direct your questions to the boards? So that it feels better.
Because, I mean, we're sitting tonight in a building that's declared what?
Hasn't been studied.
Hasn't been studied. Now, if we were over in Memorial Hall and we were all standing in the dining room area, kitchen area, we probably would end up in the basement. One of the things when you do the basement underneath, then you've got to replace all the floor on the first floor on the top, because those boards are now rotten thanks to the ones on the bottom. The rot has come straight up through. So the whole process is going to be very extensive, because you've got walls downstairs. Upstairs it's wide open space. So the combination of doing it, it's going to take a while, but it's going to take money.
Thank you for that explanation. Okay, now to the question that some have been waiting for. Why is there no access to the Veterans Memorial Monument? Kathy, would you like to answer that?
There is access. We, in the hedges, there's a cutout that we purposely put in when the question came about, well, when we put the hedges in, how's people going to get to the monument? The only thing is, you can't park on the road. You have to park out of the triangle in order to walk into it.
So how would a handicapped veteran get to the monument?
I think a while ago,
It's why we widened it for that purpose, a handicapped parking spot near that opening. Yes.
So people are having a hard time hearing, so whoever's speaking, if you could stand up.
So a while back, we added over on that side road, on the corner, where you go past the gate of the hall, we put like a wider spot for handicapped parking, and we widened the entrance. It probably needs to be widened again, but it's very easy to push a wheelchair in there or a walker that you use that you can sit on to get to the monument. That's specifically why we left that opening there. After we did it, some of the wedding parties would use it where the bride would come out the back way and come in that way so the groom didn't see them. Mm-hmm. So it's been used for that too. But that's why we put that entryway in, was because a lot of people were saying, well, now the hedges are there, how are we going to get in to see the monument? And that was our way of making it available for people to go for the monument.
So if people were going to look at the monument, they would be considered trespassing?
No, not if they're going to look at the monument.
Okay.
I'm sorry, wait a minute, please. Can you say, can you state your name, please?
My name is Matthew Mitchell. How do you distinguish the difference between somebody who's trespassing? I'm from East Calais and Marshfield. How do you differentiate the difference between somebody who's trespassing and somebody who's visiting the stone? Because you say you have those hedges with the arch cut in, but you have no trespassing signs, you know, 3 feet from it. So it's very misleading.
As we're addressed to the select board. So, Rob and Jonathan, do you have lists of people that would like to speak? About roughly how many people are there?
We've got 15 people.
To distinguish whether you're trespassing or paying attention to the monument. I mean, there's been people out there looking at the monument. I mean, I've driven up Foster Hill and seen people reading the monument and stuff. So people that are really going out to look at the monument, that's what they do. They don't wander onto the point and look around and leave bottles and stuff like that. I mean, I think it's called, you know, trusting that that's what you're doing.
Okay, so I think if we can, how many names do you have, John?
We have 17 names, so.
Total?
I believe so, so I'm going to suggest that we limit it to 2 minutes per person, or?
Maybe ask if anybody does.
Is there anyone else who would like to be added to the list? So there's a clock up here, just to facilitate the flow of the meeting, I'm going to start the clock when someone starts speaking. When there's a 30-second warning, I'm just going to politely raise my hand, and then you have 30 seconds left to.
Okay, does that sound, Stephanie?
If I have or anybody has a question for either the select board or the women's relief board, does that eat into our 2 minutes?
Well, if you take the list of questions from the crowd and then go to people's 2 minutes, that would be a really good use of everyone's time. I think we've listened to the Women's Relief Board talk for about 40 minutes. I think it would be a good use of everyone's time if you took a list of questions from the folks in the crowd and you answered them.
That's what we're doing.
Really?
That's what the whole purpose is.
There's some confusion. This meeting is built off a previous meeting. At the previous meeting, many of the same crowd, obviously not all of them, arrived at a list of questions, presented them to the select board, and asked that we have this meeting to address those questions. So here we are. At the end of the meeting, if there's time, after we've addressed these questions, and folks have provided their feedback, we will try to entertain new questions. But the focus of this meeting is to address what was presented to us last week.
If I could, just for a moment, I think the difference I'm hearing is some people might want 2 full minutes to make a statement. Some people might want to ask a question that takes 20 seconds to ask, and then have a chance to respond.
So I think we can take the statements, let people make that statement. I'm sure we don't all want to be here all night, and we may not be able to answer your questions. So any questions, and that's the purpose of the flip charts, is to keep a list of further questions other than what was presented to the board, this board, after this group met last Monday night. So does it sound like a plan if we give everybody an opportunity to speak? If it's a question that hasn't been asked, we'll write it on the board. We can take statements. And if there's questions that we can't answer, as I said, we hope we will have an opportunity to meet again at a later date and review the additional questions. Because getting a question tonight, we might not be able to answer it.
Let's go.
All right, so first up is Dorothy Singleton.
Hi, Dorothy Singleton.
Can you just say where you live?
I live in Calais, just over there. Is the select board or the town willing to take GAI Road and make it a town road just to clear that up?
As I said initially, the town believes that GAI Road historically has been a fourth-class town highway.
Right.
We treat it that way before maintenance on the highway.
So, class four.
Right.
Okay.
It's on our highway map.
It's been on the highway map since the 1950s and even before that.
Okay. Can I ask one question? We're here because one person, has been telling people they can't swim at that beach. Do we have...
The Women's Relief Corps said they have not posted that beach.
I'm talking about Tammy Lino.
I don't want to kind of put names.
Okay.
Out there, but...
I wasn't saying it was a
good that, if... The Women's Relief Corps said they have not posted the beach.
So does the town have a solution to this?
No, we don't.
It's a private property.
So,
but it's not her property.
Right. And it's their property.
Right.
So they would have to be the ones to tell
them
it's on the property.
Thank you for clearing that up.
Okay.
Thank you, Peggy.
Okay,
Rob,
who's next?
Next up is Heather Johnson.
I am Heather, I'm an East Calais resident of the Gold River and Jen Hill.
Can you talk louder, please?
So I hear from everything that was said. There's certainly been a lot of history, some of which have been around for, some of which I haven't.
But the fact remains that as long as I've been here, which is a fraction of what a lot of people have been here, that has been used as a communal beach area. And it has been, you know, it's a treasured spot to have to drive to go somewhere when I live right over here. It seems ridiculous. And I guess what I'm wondering is there a way that we can fundraise, come together as a community, I don't know, form a committee amongst all of us or whatever, to in conjunction with the Women's Relief Corps to maybe fundraise for the Memorial Hall, fixing it up, securing a beach access, like working together instead of divisions and just... Yeah.
Positive energy and the positive outcome of this meeting will be is to get people to work together. This should not be adversarial. Everybody has fond memories of the beach area, the hall, going there when they were kids to dances, all kinds of things like that. But I'm going to let the Women's Relief Corps answer or comment on Heather's comment.
We will at the end. But why don't you just continue with your...
Okay, who's next?
All right, next up, Jamie Morby.
Jamie Morby, I live in Calais up on Random Road. So I have two things, but they're sort of very similar to what was just said. So I guess to build on what Dot said, I know you're trying not to delve into this too much, but it seems to me that a big issue a lot of people in town have been facing is harassment and threats of violence to families with their children from a resident. And I know there have been a lot of reports to the Select Board and a lot of reports to Wilson Hughes and a lot of reports to the police. And I feel like there's got to be some...
What I keep telling people is the town has no authority over that area. The best thing you can do is, anybody got their windows down? Is to call the Vermont State Police. They are the ones, they are law enforcement. Select Board is not law enforcement.
The town constable is not.
I think he has limited authority over that. He really does have very limited authority. He's, you know, doing on his job.
Okay. And then my other point, which was similar to that, and maybe the Women's Relief Corps will address this at the end, but if we could work the Select Board along with you folks and town people who are interested in finding a way for the town to secure ownership or lease or right of way to that beachfront, just so that this issue doesn't continue building and keep coming up year after year in the future. I know I was a little bit involved with similar situations with the island on Curtis Pond, and I know a similar situation with the, what worked out with the ownership of the beach on Curtis Pond. So just having that conversation open.
Next up, Terrell Brambach.
I'm sorry, who?
Terrell Brambach.
Okay. My name is Terrell Brambach. I'm trying to say where I'm from until I comment.
You gotta talk really loud, right?
Until I comment upon the residence of the president of the Women's Relief Corps of the Grand Army Republic, Memorial Hall, is buried. I'm from Calais. I've been here since 1972. I currently pay $8,400 a year in property tax. That establishes that I'm legitimate as far as being from Calais. I feel like the Select Board coming in here is an intrusion on a group of people who is trying to organize a real response to the issues around access to the swimming. And it's the same Select Board that would tolerate a decision-making public meeting in the living room of Tony Talbot that closed down public access to a road in North Dallas. Tony Talbot. Last spring had a meeting in his living room with people from North Dallas advocating the closure of a road there. It's 10 Highway, I can't remember.
I wasn't part of that meeting. I can't speak to that.
Okay, but it was tolerated, and it wasn't, someone should have said, this is not legitimate, it's not our way of going forward. But I want to point out that there was a relevant state Supreme Court decision on this question of access on a pathway to a dam with a lake that was decided for the public. And that's in recent times, less than 15 years, I found it under riparian rights, state of Vermont, on about the second or third page, published by a Berlin-based advocacy group for municipal bodies on the whole question of water rights in Vermont. And that's something that should be investigated.
Okay, we will do that. Thank you very much.
Next up, Millie.
I'm not prepared. I guess I came here with the idea that maybe we could all figure out a plan to work together and come up with a solution that would allow that deer property to be utilized by the people who live here for years. I have been swimming in that lake for about 67 years, and I can't tell you how many times I've heard hassles. And when I heard that there was somebody who was naked, which in my mind is not a huge deal, I knew that was going to be an excuse to clamp down. And I just feel that it's when you start taking things away from people that they've had for years, a tremendous amount of anger gets spewed out. And I would like not to see that anger. I would like to see if we can find a way to peacefully work it out. Now, what I'm hearing, this is what I originally planned to say, but what I'm hearing is it hasn't been posted for no swimming. So all we're dealing with right now is one person who's appointed themselves the guard to the beach that she does not own. And I think to take it further is probably important for the future, because I know over the years there have been issues. But I remember when that camp was built, those people thought they owned it, but they were very open to people using it, you know. But they didn't, no one who owns the camp owns the beach, but they don't seem to know that. I think that's part of it. So I think if we can find a way to clear this up once and for all, it is in the best interest of the town. I mean, we don't need to be a fractured town. There are enough issues in this world right now that are weighing each and every one of us down that we don't need to have a big fight. We need to come together. We need to try to work it out. And that means we need the ones we need for to be available to talk.
I think there's probably nobody that would disagree with me on that. Okay.
All right, next up, Robert Mitchell.
I think.
How you doing? I'm Robert Mitchell. I live in Villas Blues Pals. I also own lots 1 and 2 over there by the beach. I question Margaret Bowen's interpretation of the original thought process of the organization. These postage stamp pieces of land were given away by your organization in 1930 to bring people out here from Barry Montpelier to enjoy the lake. So my question is, who voted this to close the beach down? Did you have an organization meeting and then vote to close the beach down?
I think they've stated before.
same time, the beach is not enclosed.
Well, indeed, we all have rights away to the beach.
You know, I really think that's an issue that you need to address directly with the Women's League for. I don't think it's going to get anywhere in the nice forum. I would encourage you to talk with these ladies.
Well, Margaret, when I had this land originally, you told me everybody had rights to the water. Then recently you said nobody has rights to the water. So were you lying to me then, or are you lying to me now?
I think that we need to get this under control.
I'm under control. I'm just questioning.
I'm just saying that
the interpretation in 1930 was for people to come out and use the lake. That's why they gave away these pieces of land. That's documented.
Like I said, okay. I think it's really quick, because this is really not an issue for this meeting. This is between you folks.
Okay, if you had a title search done when you purchased your property, you would have found that all those back names.
I did do a title search and I got the land.
The back names said access to the beach. Unfortunately, the beach that you have access to and I have access to, and even Kenny and Mr. Perry, is the beach where Mr. Walbridge is.
It says right here on the map that there's a big beach.
Someone personally, you're breaking the rule of the meeting.
Right.
Okay?
Well,
be respectful. Be respectful.
Okay.
That's all we ask.
The basement right now. You sealed up.
No. Hey.
Hey, John.
Hey. Stop. Stop.
What she said.
Stop.
End it. Folks, all right. If we're going to get into this kind of a debate and this kind of attitude, then we can all go home. Okay? This is not what this meeting is for. If you have a issue with the Women's Relief Corps and the land records and all those kinds of things, I suggest you hire yourself an attorney and figure it out. This is not the forum for this, and we will not tolerate this kind of behavior. Am I clear? All right,
next up, Rachel Seelig.
Rachel. Hi, I'm Rachel Seelig. I grew up in Calais. I don't currently live here, but my folks still live here at Gossett Marianne. And I spent a lot of my weekends here, and I have always swum and over 10 ponds. So I was pretty upset the day that I was one of the people who got yelled at. That being said, I love Memorial Hall. I think that it's a town treasure. I think that the Veterans Memorial is a really important part of our town history. And so it seems to me that we need to come up with plan, and as I've kind of been thinking about it, my thinking is a couple of possibilities. One is to have the Relief Corps open their membership up some more so that we can join them in doing the fundraising that I think hasn't happened since they found out about needing to shut down the hall. And maybe with more of us part of the organization, we can, you know, as a group, think about that as possibly a way to also manage the beach access as a challenge. The second thing I've thought about is creating a nonprofit that can help with that fundraising and try and work with the Women's Relief Corps in that way to try and kind of move ownership again in a way that would be supportive of the mission of the Corps, but also allow the town and our friends and family who don't live right here in Calais, like currently myself, to continue to enjoy and so to the extent that either of those seem like feasible options, I am here as the first volunteer for either of those. Thank you.
All set.
Next up, Stephanie Smith.
Some of my comments were addressed. I was thinking about the same thing that was just mentioned Stephanie Smith from Cass. Regarding membership and maybe increasing membership on the Women's Relief Corps to help engage in fundraising and manage access and so on and so forth and bring that back to a public use, as I know many people have enjoyed that when it was available for renting. The other thing I was wondering, and I'm not sure that anybody here tonight can actually answer this question, is related to what does the public respect to the pond, number 10 pond? Is it the high water mark? And so that's a question I don't know the answer to.
There's Mr. Winkowski here from Fish and Wildlife, but it's also a palace resident. So I'll let him answer that.
I saw him, but I couldn't put it on the spot, so I was just making it up.
I can't answer. That's really complicated, and case law has been very wishy-washy, and sometimes the high water mark really means the low water mark. So highest low point, and so it's really confusing. It's really what it comes down to. The only one I can maybe speak to a little bit, for example, is Lake Champlain. State water mark is 93.5 feet above sea level. So anything below that is public land and public water. So when we get up to 100 feet, you can go 7 feet deep, and that's private land underneath that water. So I can speak to that. That's the only one that I know that's really, truly established. Some lakes and ponds have established watermarks, and you might be able to use that as a reference, but I don't know. It's a complicated case.
Is that something that the state of Vermont defends? I mean, the Lake Champlain or not something that the state defends? No, he doesn't. Never mind. Who would establish that if it were under question? But maybe
we can have the question written down, and we can do some further research to find out.
And then I was just wondering about the GAR road and the doctrine of dedication and acceptance.
I don't think we're ready to get into that.
That's fine. I just wanted to mention it. Thank you. That's it.
All right. Thank you, Stephanie.
Next up, Lisa McCarthy.
Okay. Most of my questions.
Can you just stay where you are?
Oh, Lisa McCarthy. I used to live in that red house. I live up towards Adamant now. My question is, I hear loud and clear that the beach has not been closed, but I'm wondering if there is a plan to close it to the public or post signs.
I think that they pretty much answered that several times. But
okay. Well, I heard that it's not closed, but I'm asking, in the future, is there a plan to close it?
That's their policy. The future would be the regulations that are in place by the state and the town.
Yeah.
Well, the town has no plan to close it.
The town doesn't have any authority over that piece of property.
Right. So there's no plan to post no trespassing signs at a future.
Okay. Thank you.
Next up, Heather
Scandale.
Scandale, thank you.
Hi, I'm Heather Scandale from Callis over on County Road. And I just wanted to say, thank you for the Women's Relief Corps for coming. I think it's in a hard position for them to come and volunteer their time. And I guess I would like to know if they would take it back to the board, to their board, and ask if it could be used, that area could be used by the public. I know it was kind of just clarified, so I had to rethink about what I was gonna say, but so let me clarify that. For the board, for these ladies to go back to the board and ask if the people could use that area, not to park in that, where people park right now, but just to use that beach area. And then
everybody's got kind of a different question, but it's all the same question.
Yeah.
And I think they've answered it numerous times.
I guess, I think you're right. Maybe I'm just not hearing it really clear. Let me look at my time. I just want to be able to go there if I can go there, but I also, if they're not wanting people to go there, I want to respect that too. I just really need this really definitive line. Am I able to go with permission, or if I'm not, then I'll totally obliged by that.
What
so.
I heard them say, and they can correct me if I'm wrong, is that the beach is not posted and they have no plans to post it. That's what I heard.
Okay.
So I think you can interpret that how you
sure.
want. I don't know, is that clear? Am I restating what you said correctly?
And I believe they, unless I misunderstood, the Women's Relief Corps stated tonight that their concern is if they actually provided a grant of access to everybody, that there might be some liability tied to that.
Right.
And that's an open legal question from their perspective. So
thank you for coming, appreciate it.
All right, next up, Rhonda Grace.
Rhonda? I'll pass.
Oh, you'll pass, okay.
Okay.
Thanks. Rowan Jacobson?
Rowan Jacobson.
Rowan, sorry.
I represent the city of North Dallas. I won't repeat what a lot of people said tonight, but I think it's, from everything I'm hearing, I think it's really good for us to take kind of the long view in this situation. And starting with, I think we actually owe the Women's Relief Corps a huge thank you, because the reason we all love that area is because it's the same as it has been for 100 years, and they've done an incredible job of maintaining. So can we give them all a round of applause? Now, can we give them $300,000 in addition? It seems like it's obvious what has to happen here. There's a beach whose highest value is on the swimming beach. That's worth a lot of, that's got a lot of value to a lot of people. There's a hall that has a lot of value to a lot of people that needs money. So it seems like this is the moment to really focus this energy and in the direction where the whole town of Calais lives. And we keep going what's been going on since 1888. So it seems like a lot of the issues here actually have to do with one crazy woman's not here. So if we can pull back from that, I think we can actually have a really positive momentum going toward getting that hall in shape for the next 100 years and the point and the beach with it. So I'm not seeing any huge issues here that didn't involve a lot of misunderstandings and, you know, innuendo and front porch forum. So how do we take this to the next stage? What are the actual items that are going to allow us to preserve that swimming beach and preserve that hall? And I don't know how we can do that next, but I think that's the next place this has to go.
Okay, thank you.
Next up, Stephanie Kaplan.
Hi, my name is Stephanie Kaplan. I live on Jack Hill Road.
Louder.
My name is Stephanie Kaplan. I live on Jack Hill Road, right over that bridge there. I first just want to say that I just agree with everybody else trying to resolve this. It's really important. I love Memorial Hall. I've lived in Calais for more than 30 years and love swimming there, so I agree we need to figure out how to raise the money, how to do what we can. But in the meantime, I have some questions that I want to ask the Women's Relief Corps. And I wonder, I'll just ask them to you, Denise, so yes. I mean, they can be written down or they can answer.
Yeah, we're writing down all the questions so that we don't lose track of anything.
So one question is, I hear, and I've been told this before, that one of the reasons that they wanted to post that land was because there was this problem with one man, and that they had to post it against everybody in order to keep him off. And my question to them is, if they understood that they could post it against just one person or any individual they wanted, would that change their position about posting against everybody? Okay, that was one question. Another question has to do with the liability, that they say they're concerned about liability, which of course they wouldn't. I also want to know if their position on that would change in terms of letting people swim in other areas there of theirs, if they understood that there's a law in Vermont that exempts landowners who allow the public to use their land for recreation from any liability if they get hurt or drown or whatever. So I wanted to know if that was true and if they understood that, would they change their position about people swimming? Another question I have is, I'd like to know what the purpose of those boulders is that were put on the parking area. I'd just like to know why they're there and what they're, if they're going to be used for anything else. So those are my questions.
Okay. So do you ladies have any comments or thoughts on the questions that were just asked?
So I guess most of her first ones when we're done.
Can't hear.
Supreme Court decision on that, please pass it on. As for the boulders,
The boulders are mine. They're going on my property, not on the Women's Relief Corps property, not on the beach. And Mr. Mitchell will see the boulders.
Thank you for clearing that up. But as you know, I can imagine that there's been quite the amount of speculation and rumor and whatnot about the boulders. Thank you for clearing that up.
All right, next up is Walt Ames.
Hi, I'm Walt Ames. I live in North Calais. And my question was going to be about boulders as well. And I'm curious about which land is wooded. Is it the triangle that people park in? Because if those boulders land along the road, then there's no parking. And you don't really need to post the beach if no one can park there, because no one can park in the fishing access unless they're fishing or boating. No one can park on the road. So the boulders, in effect, do what posted signs haven't been able to do.
Right, and I think they just said what the boulders were
Peg
for.
Said they were going on her land.
Her
I'm curious as to whether or not that land is the land that people park on.
Okay, do you see the big blocks that are on the top between Jane's property and the Women's Relief Corps triangle?
Yes.
Those are being taken away, and some of those boulders are going to sit there. And she's sick and tired of looking at those big blocks, I'm sure. And then we're going to do a little bit of a hedge, or not a hedge, but a hump, and put some flowers or whatever. So those are being yanked out. Then you go around the corner at the hall where we wanted to put a parking lot. Years back, there's two big blocks there. Those are going to come out. Then when you continue on and head towards Ed Walbridge's property, there is a wall already there that was built. That's the overflow for the pond. That's on my property. There's a half a wall built there, but not completely.
That's on your personal property.
Personal property. And I've got to put some boulders there because what happened is already this year, one car ended up on the old wall in the tall grass and couldn't see it, had to be pulled out. The other one ended up in the weeds that are in what used to be the cove, which is now, I think it's about 175 feet now, the water is from the roadway. And they turned around and they trimmed that and threw the stupid brush back on my wall. So that's where they're going. And then the rest of them are going up onto the cottage lots, which I own.
Cool.
On the 50%.
Thank you, Peg.
All right, next up, Gail Graham.
Thank you for having this venue for us tonight. I think it's very important. I'm Gail Graham. I live in Calais. I grew up here in Calais. Graduated from 8th grade at Memorial Hall, and very fond of that area. I know this has been addressed.
Gail, already. Can you talk a little louder? Because you've got your back to us now, we can't hear.
It's about access.
We need you to kind of address the board.
It's about access to the area at the Memorial Hall. And I know you sort of answered it tonight. I'm also president of the Calais Historical Society. And a year ago, we anticipated having a potluck supper, a meeting, hopefully on the grounds at Memorial Hall, because we were doing the history of North Calais, and basically it was denied that we couldn't go there. So now, if we want, number one, if we want to do that, we're able to have a gathering like that.
Yeah, I think she said that the building is closed. Because
therein lies the because the breakdown in communication was not asking to use the building.
Okay, you're asking to use the property.
Correct.
The ground, okay.
So and I'm making that point because for the future, I think that needs to be clarified. That is using the grounds and not using the building.
The problem with letting someone use the grounds is when you have a function, you've got to provide toilets and stuff, and the building is closed.
Okay. Next
up, Debbie Haskins.
That would be me. So I'm Debbie Haskins, and I live in North Calais, Vermont. You read my name in the paper. I am the only Women's Relief Corps member.
I'd like to make an opening statement and then I have some questions. My opening statement is this: nobody owns the pond and the water. We are all caretakers of it. And Rowan so eloquently talked about it. I used to have nightmares if this pond ever went under, because there would be nothing for any of us. We're all caretakers of the water and the land. And it's interesting because Rowan and Eric and Mary and all of us that live on the pond, for those of you that come to visit, I was down at the access last week, like many of us, on my hands and knees, picking up glass in the access and diapers and everything else. So when you come and you say, "My God, it's beautiful," you bet it is, because we live there year round. I've lived on water all my life up in Illinois, and there's always problems. And just like the quote said, I actually asked him to call you and have some answers, because most of this is based on fear about what's going to happen to an incredibly pristine and beautiful place. I want this for seven generations to come, not just about me. I live directly across the hall, so got the benefits of the naked man, and probably saw far more than anybody. But 99% of the people in that come to this pond are amazing. They want to see the loons. That's why I put the signs out. They want to see the eagle that's always on the backside of the pond. They want to come and take pictures and swim in a beautiful, beautiful lake. That's why we're all here. So what I want to find out is, if all of these women who are over 13, who want to be part of the Women's Relief Corps and be part of the solution, I'd love to see you pony up your 30 bucks and become members. I haven't been to a meeting because we haven't been living up to our core values, and that's honoring the soldiers and the vets and what we need to be doing. And I want to figure out how to do that so that everyone can. There's a lot of misinformation. So my questions are, is the hall for sale? Is the Women's Relief Corps accepting members? How can we do solutions about having a nonprofit and help the Women's Relief Corps? Is that what it takes to make sure that not only the building and the beach, but the water stays the way it is, so that we can have our fisherman Dick sit there and be our eyes and be able to fish always and all the generations to come? Because I am concerned. And this is what I said in my statement that one press reporter got. We need more people working together, not less.
Do you want to answer any of Debbie's questions?
Not yet. You done?
No, we have two
we've
more.
Got two more. We've got Andrew Nemi.
Nemethy.
Pardon me. Thank you.
I live in the Adamant side of Calais. Some of you know me as a longtime reporter. I don't have a statement. I'm not in statements. I do have a vision. I worked with Peg Bowen for years at the Vermont Association of Snow Travelers. She's a longtime volunteer, and I know her very well as a good person, and I'm sorry that this is somewhat falling on her head, but I think there's a lot of confusion about this whole what happened from reading about it in the press, whether that was correct or not, and people in individual incidents. So we have a very muddled picture of what's going on. I'm out by there today, and there was at least 30 people there. They were kayaking, there were kids, and it was your classic peaceful scene. I thought to myself, what's all the fuss about? But obviously I wasn't there when the ship was going down, as they say. So, first off, I want to commend the select board for wading into this. This is a tough issue. It's legal. It's, I think, moral, because there's so many of us who came here in the 70s had swimming holes. I'm not sure I'm getting emotional. Had swimming holes that they went to. They've all been closed. There were three on the Mad River that I used to go to. All of them are closed. That's why people come and bury. My ex used to, went to Montpelier High School, went to the small high school with grades 1 to 6 in East Montpelier. Their swimming hole was Bliss Pond. That's how clean it was. Today, you take a life in your hands going to this spot. So these places are becoming pure, they're becoming precious. And that's why everybody here is up in arms about it. My vision is that the board, this town, gets together and we do look at the ways to turn that entire peninsula, willing buyers, willing sellers, turn it into a town, beach town asset. I went to a wedding, I've been to actually two events. I've been to several events there, and I really, this is something we need to preserve.
Thank you. I'm Cynthia Johnson. I wrote the piece in Front Porch Forum, and I'm not confused at all. I was told not to talk about questions to the Women's Relief Corps, but I do have a few more since many other people have asked. And
you mean questions for our ongoing list?
Sure. Okay. So I'm not confused about the beach being said it was going to be closed, because if Peg Bowen remembers, there was a day I was having trouble with the one person whose name I won't mention on the right of way. And the question is, or what I heard that day from Peg Bowen in her car, was that something about it was the weed whacking that happened on that beach, which has been done for decades, and by the owner of one of the private cottages. And she said, I'm closing down the beach this week. All right, that's what she said. So a lot of us assumed it's the boulders, and with the state for erosion. Okay, so then the other question is that the person I can't mention, that one person posted the beach with the sign and the parking lot, private, beach closed for private party. Now I was told by that person that she actually had permission from Peg Bowen. I don't necessarily believe her, and I ignored it. But a lot of people were chased off as a result. So I guess the question is, did Peg ever give Tammy, that person, permission to close down the beach? Okay, so then I just want to make this quick. I really want Peg to have an Relief Corps. I want a meeting with them so we can talk this out. And, I've been trying to figure out how many members are active in the Women's Relief Corps. I only know three, a couple more. Okay.
30 seconds.
Okay, let's see. Okay, I'll just say that in terms of the access to the Veterans Monument, I think it'd be good to have signs that make it clear that all veterans people are welcome to visit the memorial there, and a handicap sign too. And the other thing is, I was there at the Naked Man Select Board meeting, and when I asked, why can't he just be asked to not trespass, and she said, you're all trespassing, and the signs have been up for years. It's just really ugly now with 10 times more.
Okay, thank you very much. All right. Thank you, Rob and Jonathan, for taking that piece. All right. So what we've got here now is, I think there's a lot of really positive, most comments have been in really positive, really wanting to help the Women's Relief Corps continue its mission, finding out a way to help with some funding. So I would like to now hear from the Women's Relief Corps, who said they would comment at the end. Are you ready to comment? You said you would make a comment at the end.
Sure. Not first.
You've got to stand up though again. Sorry.
Stand up.
Women's Relief Corps has gotten old. We're all old. You guys are getting there someday too, those of you who aren't yet. Anyway, they're tired and they're worn out. Basically, the deal is this. If a nonprofit can get organized to come up with the money that's needed to repair it and to pay something for the property,
to whom?
It goes to the National Women's Relief Corps. It does not go to anyone in this town or who belongs to the local Women's Relief Corps. Okay. And the National Women's Relief Corps needs money too. So, if I felt generous, I would say, well, they don't need it, but yeah, they do. So if you can get a plan together within a month and a half or 2 months, it doesn't have to be one set of persons. It can be two or three different plans. But get it together. This is what we've got. This is what we think we need. And this is how we're going to do it. And meet with us to go over it. Then there's a positive conversation. Whatever happens, whatever group takes this on, you can be assured we will not be there telling you what to do.
Eastern Seaboard, actually, because a lot of the other states have given it up. It can't be joined, you cannot join our core and make decisions on what we own at the present time. They ask it because the state gave up the state Women's Relief Corps as well. You have to join the national. When you join the national, you don't have any say in anything local. So what we're saying is, I've got a lot of older members that belong to the Women's Relief Corps who've got one foot in the grave, to be honest. So joining the Women's Relief Corps just because you think that's going to do something for you, it's not. What you need to do is to get a rich person who wants to buy the whole damn point. They can probably buy the cottage lots as well, because I think everybody wants to sell their piece of the cottage lot.
No.
Then the road, then the point, than the building. But before you put that all together, and you can do it with the swimming, you can figure out who's in charge of the swimming, who's in charge of the road. If it's the town, then you get on their case. And you put a proposition together. But you're going to have sufficient money set aside to fix the building as well.
Fine.
We're not just saying we're going to sell you the building and the land and you can't fix the building.
You haven't done anything.
Who's the
okay.
Lead?
No, I think that's...
I think the issue
is about joining, then I would suggest you get the information from them of who to contact, if that's a huge issue for you. I see this currently that we've come a huge way tonight, and I really, really appreciate everybody's positive comments. Wanting to help, I think that the Women's Relief Corps might even be surprised at how much people other than Depot care. And I think it's genuine. I'm hearing a lot of good ideas here.
And this would be presented to our entire Relief Corps. And the other thing is, everybody, there was a little chit-chat in the paper. I'm sick and tired of hearing her say stuff in the paper. Mm-hmm. If you want to tell the paper something, go look it up. That I was taking care of the building. 45 years ago, I was asked by one of the older members to take care of the building and the land. Yep. The rest of you guys on the Relief Corps wanted to be president, secretary, treasurer, do all these other things. I've been the one that's taken care of the building and made sure that it's standing to this point. Because when I joined, it was rocking on four blocks.
Yep.
Period. It has a foundation, it has a new roof, it has a lot of things that we've done to that building and to the land.
Okay.
And I'm willing to think
we have so many problems with those people trespassing nakedly, then you can't get to the monument. We were going to talk about moving the monument to the town hall.
And then we discovered that it might not be in good enough shape right now to possibly move.
Right. But, and I don't want to cut anything off, but I'd like, I think this is ending on a positive note, so I'd like us to end there. And if folks are interested, contact Peg, Doc, or Kathy, and see what you can all come up with for a plan.
Hey, Denise, I think Tom's had his hand up for a while.
Oh, I'm sorry, Tom.
Tom Carl, from Lightning Ridge Road. Just one question I haven't heard the answer to is, I'm wondering if the Women's Relief Corps delegated enforcement authority to anybody in town other than a member of the Women's Relief Corps for trespass?
Right now, we have the Washington County Sheriff's Office and state police.
Right. No other individual has been delegated?
That's what they're saying.
Okay, thank you.
All right, so this has been excellent.
So you all heard that. The answer is no.